بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. نأمل من الإخوة الجلوس في أماكنهم. سنبدأ بالجلسة الأولى التي سيعقبها جلسة حوار، ونأمل من الإخوة الذين يستخدمون الخليوي أجهزة الموبايل أن يغلقوها، والمحاضرة ستكون باللغة الإنجليزية، فإذا الترجمة ستكون إلى اللغة العربية. والموضوع الذي سيتناوله الأخ الدكتور فاضل سليمان هو موضوع حيوي وملح، ويشكل بأهميته ودلالاته موضوعاً للكثير من الإسهامات التي نحتاجها في مختلف الفروع، وتحديداً في السياسة، لأن فقه الأولويات هو فقه عملي تدبيري بالدرجة الأولى، وقد يكون من مصادقه بعض العبادات، لكن في الغالب هو موضوع للشؤون التدبيرية وشؤون المعاملات بين الناس. فقه المعاملات هو منطق عقلي البشر يدركونه بالفطرة، لكن عملية تفعيل هذا الأولويات والتأمل بها ومعرفة المصالح والخيرات التي يمكن أن تترتب على الأولويات هي المسألة التي قد يخطئ الإنسان في تقدير أمورها، لكن العقل البشري يهتدي إليها بالفطرة وباعتبار الإنسان منطقي بالطبع. أترك المحاضرة أو الكلام للدكتور فاضل، ونأمل منه أن يلتزم بالمدة المحددة وهي نصف ساعة فقط.
شكرا سيدي الرئيس. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا رسول الله. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. All praises are due to Allah, the creator, the cherisher, and the sustainer of this universe, and may his peace and blessings be upon his noble prophet Muhammad and his companions and followers and descendants, dear respected brothers and sisters. Jazakumullah khairan for coming. I will go directly into the point. Actually, my point today is about the simplification of fiqh al-awlawiyat, the fiqh of priorities or jurisprudence of priorities. Because actually, many people or many scholars today say that fiqh al-awlawiyat should not be taught to the public because the public may misunderstand it. They may misinterpret it or misuse it, and many people will definitely manipulate it. Well, this is exactly the case with the Quran also. Many people misunderstand the Quran, misinterpret the Quran, and many people are manipulating the Quran. Shouldn't we teach people the Quran, actually? I am against assigning ourselves as guardians over the minds of people. This is ilm, and this is something that can, what I will prove to you today is that it can be simplified because it is actually very, very important. Ibn Taymiyyah said, the wise is not the one who knows good from evil. Actually, everybody knows what's good and what's evil. We can all differentiate between good and evil. But he said, the wise is the one who knows the better one of two good choices and the worse of two bad choices. So that's why, because we live in a world of choices, all Muslims need to understand and need to learn how to choose between alternatives. We need to tell them how this religion is very profound and it tells them how to choose. When you go to a restaurant, they serve you first the menu. They give you the menu in the beginning, a price list. You need to choose. Would you like a starter? The starter costs like £5. Or would you like a main course for 12? Or would you like just a soup for 3? So there's a price list. Also in religion, there is a price list also. As Sheikh Qaradawi mentioned and Dr. Asama Bashir mentioned, there is a price list in religion. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَجْعَلْتُمْ سِقَايَةَ الْحَاجِّ وَعِمَارَةَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ كَمَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَجَاهَدَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ لَا يَسْتَوُونَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. Do you make the giving of drink to pilgrims or the maintenance of the sacred mosque equal to the pious service of those who believe in Allah and the last day and strive within the cause of Allah, they are not comparable in the sight of Allah. So in this religion, there is a price list. Obligations are not equal. We have pillars of Islam. We have fara'id rukniyah, arkan. And we have normal fara'id. We have general obligations. Actually, the haram is not equal also. We have major sins, super sins, kaba'ir. And we have minor sins. Halal also, we have duty, al-wajib. We have the sunnah. We have the preferable. We have the just al-mubah, al-allowed. So we need to understand the how can we simplify for the public all these things. Number one, the public have to understand that this Sharia is designed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect five main things, which is called the Maqasid Kulliyah, or the universal ultimate goals of the Sharia, which Dr. Abdul Wahab Abu Sulaiman yesterday said that he tried to find other maqasid that cannot be listed under one of those five, and he couldn't. So any other maqasid, you will see that it can be listed under those five categories. Number one is to protect and preserve ad-deen, faith. Two, to protect and preserve life and nafs. Three, to protect and preserve al-aql, mind. Four, to protect and preserve the progeny and nasl. Five, to protect and preserve the wealth or al-mal. And here we need also to show the public that there are different categories of maslaha. So there are necessities, there are needs, there are luxuries. There are darurat, there are hagiyat, and there are tahsiniyat that are needed for to protect and preserve every one of those five. So for faith, there are necessities to protect the faith, which are the five pillars of Islam. You need to actually, it is necessary for you to do sawm in Ramadan, to give your zakah if you have money, in order to protect your faith. And there are needs, the general obligations. It is needed for your faith to cover your awrah. Okay. And there are luxuries. You can go to Umrah every year. You can go do Hajj every year. That's a luxury. It's not needed for your faith, and it's not a necessity also. Same thing goes for the five also, but because of the time limitation, I have to skip this, because usually I give it to people and tell them, give them examples on necessities, needs, and luxuries of protecting each one of those five maqasid kulliya, or universal ultimate goals of the Sharia. To simplify this for the public, we actually categorized, or we made six golden rules of fiqh al-awlawiyat. Rule number one, priority must be given to a necessity over a need, and to a need over a luxury. Take an example. Uncovering the awra in case of a doctor consultation or a surgery. Which, yani, when a woman goes to a doctor, and the doctor tells her to take off her clothes, for example, to examine her, how can she decide to do that or not? Here, covering the awra is a need to preserve the faith. And medical treatment is a necessity to preserve life. So here we will have to choose between a need and a necessity. As I said, the rule says necessity should be given priority over the need. So here she will choose to uncover her awra in order for the doctor to examine her. Same goes with men also. Example number two. Prohibition of hijab in schools for some students, which actually happens in Europe, in some countries. And it's heartbreaking, actually, when I went, and in our recent film, we filmed the Muslim girls taking off their hijab before entering the school. But, of course, Muslims have to fight to change this politically and peacefully. But at the same time, what if they can't change it? Do we keep our girls away from school? Don't we send our girls to school? Here we need to understand, how can we choose?
Covering the awra is a need to preserve faith. And seeking knowledge, actually, or education is a necessity to preserve the mind. Here again, we have to choose between a need and a necessity. So we will choose to send the girls to school, even though they will have to take off their scarves before entering the school, until this tragedy ends, inshallah. Rule number two. If the two competing interests, لو المصلحتين, if the two competing interests are not, actually are on the same level, either necessities, both of them are necessities, or both are needs, or both are luxuries, then the order of the ultimate goals of the Sharia should be considered as follows. And here I took the famous order of Al-Imam al-Shatibi and Al-Imam Abu Hamid al-Ghazali, which is number one comes faith, number two comes life, number three comes mind, number four comes progeny, number five comes wealth. Let's take an example. If force is used against a Muslim to make him drink alcohol, if someone pulls out a gun and puts it in your head and orders you to drink alcohol or he shoots you down, do you drink or not? Let's know. I don't know how. Let's think. Let's see it in the fiqh of priorities. Now drinking becomes a necessity to preserve your life. And at the same time, I'm sure that if any one of us drinks just a sip like that, he will pass out in few seconds because we don't drink. We're not, you actually, I'll be high in just a half a minute. So also abstaining from drinking or refusing to drink is a necessity to preserve my mind. So here we are choosing between two necessities. So what we will do is we will consider the order of the ultimate goals. So life comes before mind. Here we will choose to drink in order to save the life. Jihad. And jihad, of course, here in Europe, I have to explain that I don't mean bombing any trains. I mean fighting to establish justice, which is, for example, to defend your homeland or to establish justice and remove oppression. It is a necessity to protect the faith. But at the same time, it puts your life in danger. So here, it's a necessity to protect the faith and a necessity not to fight in order to protect your life. Here, faith comes before life. That's why we choose to fight and defend our homeland. Rule number three. If the two competing interests are on the same level, which means both are necessities or both are, are luxuries or both are needs, and they cater to the same ultimate goal, both cater to life or cater to faith or cater to any one of those five ultimate goals, the public interest should be given more priority over the interest of the individual. For example, this is the famous example of a tatarrus. If the enemy uses a number of Muslims as human shields and starts invading the Muslim country, should the Muslims fight the enemy and shoot at the enemy or not? If they shoot at the enemy, they will definitely kill many of the Muslims who are taken as human shields. So here, fighting the enemy back is a necessity to protect the life of many Muslims. But abstaining from fighting the enemy is a necessity to protect the life of few Muslims, the human shields. Here, we're comparing between two necessities, darurat, and both of them cater to the same ultimate goal, which is life. Here, we will give priority to the public interest, al-maslaha al-amma, than the interest of the individuals. Rule number four. If given a choice between two evils, one must choose the lesser evil. If you have to choose between two mafsadatin, you have to choose the lesser evil. In Surah Al-Kahf, it's very clear. وَأَمَّا السَّفِينَةُ فَكَانَتْ لِمَسَاكِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ فِي الْبَحْرِ فَأَرَدْتُ أَنْ أَعِيبَهَا وَكَانَ وَرَاءَهُمْ مَلِكٌ يَأْخُذُ كُلَّ سَفِينَةٍ غَصْبًا. The righteous servant of Allah tells Prophet Moses about the ship. It was owned by poor people who work in the sea as fishermen, and I wanted to make a defect in it because there was a king behind them confiscating all ships by force. So the harm of defecting the ship is just defecting, not defecting it in a way that makes it sink. No, but just defecting it in a way that makes the king lose interest in this defected ship. So defecting the ship is mafsada, harm. But you do it in order to avoid the bigger mafsada, which is losing the ship completely. Rule number five. If the interest, if an interest and an evil mix together, لا في عندنا مصلحة ومفسدة مختلطتين. If they mix together, what do? Of course, there's a rule here that we all know that دفع المفسدة مقدم على جلب المصلحة. That avoiding the evil should be done in order to, even if you don't get the interest. But actually, this is not absolute. You have to weigh both the mafsada and the maslaha. The value of the evil and the value of the interest. If the evil is huge and the interest is minimal, here, of course, we have to remove the evil, ندفع المفسدة, and let's lose the maslaha here. For example, يسألونك عن الخمر والميسر. قل فيهما إثم كبير ومنافع للناس وإثمهما أكبر من نفعهما. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Baqarah, they ask you about wine and gambling. Say, in them there is a great sin and some profits for people, but their sin is greater than the profit. Since the evil is greater than the interest here, then we can just avoid doing this evil. Example number two. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and this example is so important for us here in Europe. We all know that a brother killed Theo van Gogh in Holland about 10 years ago. Because Theo van Gogh made a terrible documentary about Islam. The Prophet, peace be upon him, also had hypocrites. He is called Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, who caused a lot of troubles. And his own son told the Prophet, allow me to kill him. And the Prophet said, no, lest people think that Muhammad is killing his companions. Because people in Arabia saw him among the companions of the Prophet, the people around the Prophet. So killing him is an interest in getting rid of this troublemaker who is really a criminal and he deserves to be killed. But if you kill him, you are tarnishing the image of Islam and we are doing da'wah to people. That's exactly what happened in Holland, actually, by killing Theo van Gogh, who was a loser and no one watched his videos except after he was killed. He was made shaheed there. So the harm, also here, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal chose to stay in jail and suffer from torture, which is a harm, it's evil, but much less than the evil of many people deviating. Rule number six. If the interest and the evil mix together and we weigh the value of the evil versus the interest and then we find that the interest is huge while the harm is minimal, we should give priority to seeking the interest rather than avoiding the evil. And I give here three or four examples and I will end by that, by the way. Okay. A Muslim is allowed to tell a lie in order to reconcile between two quarrelers, or please his or her spouse, or deceive the enemy during time of war. Well, telling a lie is a sin. It's a big sin. But at the same time, it can be a small sin when you look at a big interest that come like strengthening the relationship with your spouse. For example, if you tell your wife, I love your cooking. Maybe you're a liar here. But here, this strengthens your relationship. Here, it's a compliment. Even though it's a lie, but it's a compliment here. Here, the Prophet, peace be upon him, allowed it. Because the outcome is big. Also, reconciling between two people. For example, you go to reconcile between two people and you find one of them telling you, he is Ibn Kaza, and he calls him bad names. So you go to the other one and tell him, actually, I went to him and he said very good things about you. So you are reconciling. And the Prophet said, إِنَّمَا يُنْمِي خَيْرًا. He's just growing the good between them, growing good relations between them. under conditions of torture and extreme oppression, a Muslim is allowed to pretend to be a disbeliever or even say a word that shows him as a disbeliever to save his life. And Ammar ibn Yasir went to the Prophet ﷺ crying. He said, "O Prophet of Allah, they tortured me and I had to insult you." He said, with the word of kufr, if someone insults Prophet Muhammad, he becomes kafir. "I had to insult you." And the Prophet said, "And how did you find your heart?" He said, "My heart was full of iman." He said, "Fa'in adu fa'ud." If they do it again, do it again. Why? Because actually, the interest of saving his life is much bigger than saying a word while he doesn't really believe in it. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he himself erased Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim and Muhammad Rasulullah from the Al-Hudaybiyah Treaty. Why? That's harm. That's evil, actually. But it's a very minimal evil when you look at signing the Hudaybiyah Treaty itself with the Prophet himself wanted it so much because actually strategically the Muslims needed it. And the problem is that Prophet Muhammad, we know him only as a prophet, but he was never presented to us as Muhammad the thinker or Muhammad the planner, the strategic planner. But he needed it so much because there were, as you see, that it was not, he didn't need it because he was a man of peace. Like people say, he loves peace, he's a man of peace, so he wanted peace. No, actually, he needed it, and as soon as he needed it, as soon as he signed it, they went and they fought in Khaybar, and he sent four armies to the north fighting the Romans in Daumat al-Jandal, in Dhat al-Salasil, in Mu'ata, and in Tabuk. So signing al-Hudaybiyah Treaty was a bigger interest than just removing those two words by the hand of the Prophet himself. Example number four, a Muslim is allowed to run for office in a non-Muslim country or in an unjust government to minimize the evil and to maximize the interest. And here we have the example of Yusuf, alayhi salam. قَالَ اجْعَلْنِي عَلَى خَزَائِنِ الْأَرْضِ إِنِّي حَفِيظٌ عَلِيمٌ. Yusuf said, "Set me over the storehouses of the land and I will indeed guard them with full knowledge as a minister of finance in Egypt." It was a non-Muslim country. It was actually a non-Muslim government. And still, a Muslim ran for office in order to minimize the evil. He knows that he cannot change everything. But at least he will minimize the mafasid as much as he can. Jazakumullah khairan wa barakallahu fikum.
نريد مداخلات حوالي 6 أو 7 مشاركين وعلى أن تزيد لا تزيد مدة المشاركة أو السؤال على 2 دقيقة لنختم هذه المحاضرة بردود المحاضر إن شاء الله.
Until they bring the microphone, I need to say something. I'm here actually not to be asked questions about the topic. Actually, the fiqh al-awlawiyat, we have much better actually people who can deal with it than me, but actually to criticize me. And I'm waiting also for comments from my own scholars actually. Should we go further and do this to the public and give them this knowledge as long as it's simplified like that, or shouldn't we?
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Muhammad Ali Ahdash, the Muslim College. My comment is it has to be added that this rule is needed to be in the hands of scholars. It is not for the public to use them, to apply them. It is just for the scholars who can apply these rules to the case in question. Thank you.
My name is Abdurrahman Ibn Yusuf Mangera. I think there could be a danger in opening this up to the public. One of the examples that you, the Sheikh Fadil, quoted was about Abdullah ibn Ubay bin Salul. You use his example to show that what the person in Holland, was it Holland? Holland had done was completely wrong, but I personally I think it seems more of a qiyas ma'al fariq, because Van Gogh was clearly a disbeliever in opposition. Abdullah ibn Ubay bin Surul, the tricky part about him is that he expressed himself as a believer. I think we have another example during the seerah, and that is of Ka'b ibn Ashraf. His example seems much better because he was a writer, a poet, etc., an open enemy, and the Prophet ﷺ had him killed. This is in no way to justify a killing in the West by Muslims. I just want to make that clear because you don't know who's listening. But I think the first one seems to be a qiyas ma'al fariq, and that's why I see it can be abused, because what kind of qiyas are you going to do? Wallahu a'lam. Jazakallah khair.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Walaikum salam. I wanted to make a point that I believe that it should be taught to the public, because especially Muslims living in the West, we're always facing challenges, we're always facing problems, and we should be informed and be able to make these kind of decisions and know where to make the right decisions and make Islamic and proper decisions. Because like you said, we're, as Muslims, we're always in the public eye and we're always doing dawah. So, and every Muslim has been blessed with a brain and a heart and iman. And I think we should use our faculties to the fullest. And even in the whole point of this conference was opening up dialogue, opening up discourse. So if we want to move together and forward as a society and as a Islamic civilization, I think it should be opened up to the public.
Assalamu alaikum. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Jazakallah khair, Dr. Fadel Soliman. I have much benefited from his YouTube lectures, and I consider him a great American Muslim evangelist, if I can describe him. Just I comment on one thing that the you mentioned about. I agree with all these principles, but just I comment on the tone that the you and some other scholars, they mentioned about hijab and uncovering bodies. Actually, in 80s, there were a very few sisters who used to cover their face, but then now their number increase. And I feel that the generation, young generation in this country, they have a stronger iman than us. And those people who still keep talking about taking off hijab and scarf, the generation will not listen to them. To know about the principle is a very good thing. Yeah, about the hospital in this country, there is a facilities available, and because the patients are considered as customers for hospitals, so I give talk every month to doctors and nurses, and we teach them that the how to care for Muslims. So one aspect that the Muslim, they should know that there is a permission, but actually in this country, there are more facilities than even in many Muslim countries. Jazakallah khair.
Assalamu alaikum. بالنسبة للمرأة إذا يعني بالنسبة إذا تعرض نفسها على طبيب أو طبيبة هي إلها choose إنه option إنه ممكن هذه في حالة إنه إذا لم تكن هناك طبيبة نسائية بهالحالة ممكن أن تختار يعني هذه النقطة الثانية بالنسبة للسلاح إذا يوجه للإنسان في حالة إنه يقوم بشيء الدين يرفضه أو محرم أو ليس محرم هل يأثم الإنسان إذا رفض أن يقوم بالشيء وانقتل في هذا السبيل هل يأثم هل الله سبحانه وتعالى لا يقبل من عنده لأنه في سبيل الله هو يمكن يرضى الموت ولا يقبل بالشيء اللي يحرم الدين شكرا
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Within this maslaha and mufsada, I would like to submit to you a theoretical situation that some brothers were raising a few years ago. There was a discussion, an intellectual exercise in a theoretical Muslim state. You have got a strong Muslim state, and you have got a very strong anti-Islamic force within that state, and there is a bomb that has been placed somewhere in a public place, and it's going to cause real mayhem, real havoc. And one of these people were caught, the opposition people were caught, would that person be tortured to try and find out where the bomb is? Or we couldn't do that, we can't do that. We never had the answer anyway.
Okay, آخر سؤال. تفضل.
السلام عليكم. تحدثت عن فقه الأولويات فيما يتعلق في مجال عبادات، لكن سؤالي عن فقه الأولويات في مجال آخر. عندما يأتي الإنسان إلى هذه البلد وتكفل له من الحقوق والحريات ومن تعليم جل ما افتقده في بلاده، ثم عندما ينشأ ويكبر ويشتد سوقه وعوده، عندما تحدث عن فقه الأولويات في مجال أولوياته النهضوية وأهدافه، هل يتوجه بجميع أهدافه النهضوية وخدمة أمته وبلده الأم ويجحد هذه البلد التي منحت له الجنسية بناء على عقد؟ لأن بعض الشباب عندما تكون هناك مثلا أعمال تطوعية بصفة عامة فقط يتوجه للأعمال التطوعية الإسلامية، وعندما تكون أعمال تطوعية بصفة عامة إنسانية لا يشارك فيها بصفة والله هذه تخدم مسيحيين تخدم ديانات ثانية ويجحد هذه البلد. بس حبيت أسمع رأيك في هذه النقطة.
طيب شكرا.
Can I start from the last question actually? Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم when he left Mecca, he left with tears in his eyes and he looked back and he said, "Oh Mecca, let know that you are the dearest country to my heart, and had not your people dragged me out of you, I could have never left you." And after 8 years, Mecca was opened back for him and he did not live there. He stayed in his new country that gave him support and he loved it also so much. And he said, to the extent that he said, "Oh Allah, bear witness that had I not been an immigrant, I could have been one of the people of Medina, and if the people of Medina go anywhere, I will be following them." So actually the Prophet loved Medina so much. So loving the country that gives you, or actually your birth country is normal and it is inside, yani it's in your fitrah. But at the same time, loving the country that gave you support also is in your fitrah. And the problem here is that I wish to see, you know, the Muslim youth who were born here to feel like they are British Muslims. There is no contradiction between being British and British Muslims. And as this country gave you its best, you give it its your best, and your best is Islam. So you have to, I believe that every Muslim should be a da'i. And that's what I understand from the verse of Surah Yusuf 108 that says, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي قُلْ يَا مُحَمَّدْ Say, O Muhammad, this is my way. So this is the way of the Prophet. أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ I make da'wah to Allah. عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ With sure knowledge. Me and those who follow me. Any followers of Prophet Muhammad here? All of us. So all of us should know how to speak about Islam. I don't mean that we need 1.6 billion lecturers to give lectures about Islam. No. But at least when you are asked about Islam, you should be able to answer. If you stop a Christian in the street and you ask him about Christianity, he tells you, Jesus died for me. Very spiritual. You stop a Muslim and you ask him, what's Islam? He scratches his head for 5 minutes and he says, we don't drink alcohol. Okay, what else? We don't eat pork. Is this number one and number two to say about Islam? Do you know that Islam is the only religion in the world which is not called after someone? Not called Judaism after the tribe of Judas. Only Buddhism after Buddha. Islam is called after who? Not Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There's a lot to say about Islam, but we need to learn that. So yes, you can love this country that gave you support and you need to give it also your best, but this means that you need to do da'wah here. You need to do da'wah at the same time you work as a doctor, as a professor, as whatever. Talking about Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf, many people think that Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf was killed because he made poetry attacking Prophet Muhammad and his wives. Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf, if you look in Al-Jam' al-Ahkam al-Qur'an for Al-Qurtubi, the tafsir of Al-Qurtubi, in Surah Al-Nisa, I believe, verse number 51 or 55. You see that Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf went out with 70 Jews to Mecca and they signed a treaty with Quraysh to fight the Prophet Muhammad and the Muslims. So you're speaking about a citizen of Medina who went to Israel and he signed with the Mossad. Well, Quraysh, well, Mecca at that time is not beautiful Mecca that we go to and we make Umrah and buy things from Bin Dawood. No. Mecca at that time was Israel at that time for the Muslim world, of course. And Quraysh at that time was the Mossad. So you're speaking about a militant. So you're speaking about a sleeping cell. And the Prophet ﷺ dismantled this cell by killing only the head of the cell. It's not because he wrote poetry. Talking about the example with Theo van Gogh, I am here comparing the harm with the interest. But not Theo van Gogh to Abdullah ibn Salul. But the harm and getting rid of Van Gogh and getting rid of Abdullah ibn Salul are the same interest. And tarnishing the image of Islam in the eyes of the non-Muslims is the same harm. That's why the qiyas that I did. Saying that this type of, or this branch of knowledge is dangerous for the public that they may use or abuse, I dealt with this in the first, actually. Well, this can be a teaser for them. Well, actually, still the public, we tell them a little bit about usul al-fiqh, and still they don't do ijtihad. So we tell them this is a teaser. And it's good for a Muslim to see how profound is his religion and how that there are rulings that the scholars use, but not necessarily that he will use. But it's a teaser for them to increase in them the need to learn about this religion. Ta'dhib, torturing. We made a film called Dying, it's called Jihad on Terrorism.